السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We concluded yesterday's lesson mentioning that Imam Malik rahimahullah, he condensed this report. He made ikhtisar of it. So he's not transmitting the full narration. Now there are various other scholars and narrators who quoted this here, and they explain how Jibreel alayhi salam showed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam the beginning time of the Asr on the one day and the end time of Asr on the next day. So since Jibreel alayhi salam prayed Asr before the shadow of anything could reach twice its length, Urwah, he intends telling Umar ibn Abdul Azīz that he needs to pray his Asr before that. But the question is raised that why is there ikhtisar of the marfu' portion of this narration in the Muwaṭṭa? That why did Imam Malik rahimahullah not quote the marfu' portion in full, the incident of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in full? Why did he make ikhtisar of the portion that explains the prayers of Jibreel alayhi salam with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Actually, was it Imam Malik rahimahullah who made ikhtisar of this hadith which comes in this incident, or was it his source? Was it someone higher up in the chain? So in response to that, some scholars, they explained that it was actually the Sahabi Abu Mas'ud radiallahu anhu who condensed and made ikhtisar of this narration. And therefore, most of those who quoted from him, they all quoted it mukhtasaran. They quoted it in the a condensed version. But then that raises the question, okay, then why did Abu Mas'ud quote this in short? So to respond to this, Ibn Ashur, he claimed that Abu Mas'ud mentioned this incident briefly because he was convinced that Mughira was fully aware of all the details. So he says in Kashf al-Mughatta on page 61, وَقَدْ اخْتَصَرَ أَبُو مَسْعُودٍ الْحَدِيثَ لِأَنَّهُ وَكَّلَهُ إِلَى مَا فِي عِلْمِ الْمُغِيرَةِ مِنْ تَفْصِيلِهِ. So this here is the response of Ibn Ashur. However, we notice that Abu Bakr ibn Hazm and Usama ibn Zayd, they did actually transmit this in full. So that shows that it can't be Abu Mas'ud radiallahu anhu who condensed it. Rather, it will have to be one of the narrators below, because that's the only way that these two narrators, Abu Bakr ibn Hazm and Usama ibn Zayd, is the only way that they would get the full version is if they heard it in full. They cannot be making up the report, isn't it? So they heard it in full, and then that is how they transmitted it in full. But the others, they heard it and they then condensed it. So it means that sometimes, now going very particular through this link, or through this chain rather, it means that sometimes Ibn Shihab, rahimahullah, he quoted this in full, and that is how his student Usama ibn Zayd heard it from him in full. And at other times, he quoted it briefly, and that is how the seven other students heard it briefly. So whether it is the repeating of five prayers or counting 10 prayers, or whether it is explaining the beginning or end time of the prayers, Ibn Shihab rahimullah, sometimes he quoted the full details and at other times he quoted it briefly. So Imam Malik rahimullah, when he heard it from Ibn Shihab briefly, and therefore he quoted it in this way in his Muwatta. Nevertheless, the objective of Imam Malik rahimullah for bringing this narration under this chapter of Muqutu Salah is because he wants to establish the time of the Asr Salah. So this chapter is on the times of Salah, and the first narration is on the time of the Asr prayer. Actually, whoever quoted this particular narration, they always used it to establish the time of Asr Salah. So therefore, Alama Ibn Abdul Bar rahimahullah, he mentions in At-Tamhid in volume 5 on page 398, كل من ذكر هذا الحديث من المصنفين إنما ذكره في باب تعجيل العصر. They all quoted the siyah to show that you should read your Asr Salah very early. Now going back to the narration, the next words are, فقال عمر بن عبد العزيز اعلم ما تحدث به يا عروة. So Umar ibn Abdul Azīz said, think of what you are saying, O Urwah. That means that after Urwah mentioned this incident of Mughira and the narration of the imamat of Jibreel alayhi salam, Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is now telling Urwah to think about what he is saying. That Urwah must make sure that what he is quoting accurately.
And this is how most of the students transmitted this response of Umar ibn Abdul Azīz. However, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, rahimullah, he quoted that Umar ibn Abdul Azīz actually told Urwah to fear Allah. So in Musnad al-Shafi'i, on page 28, it comes, فَقَالَ عُمَرُ بْنُ عَبْدِ الْعَزِيزِ اِتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَا عُرْوَهُ انظر مَا تَقُولُ. The fear Allah, O Urwah. Think, what are you saying? So now can you picture it? You got 25-year-old Umar ibn Abdul Azīz sitting there. You know, in your 25 years, your beard is not even grown properly. So you got like a very young person sitting there, Umar ibn Abdul Azīz. And then you have this elderly and senior mufti and this, from the fuqaha al-sab'a, a well-respected tabi'i, Urwah. And then this youngster, he's telling this faqih and this great and elderly person that ittaqillah, and make sure, think of what you're saying. Make sure that you are quoting accurately. Can you picture this whole thing? Now, this does not for a moment means that Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is doubting Urwah. Rather, you can see that he is the governor. He's keeping Urwah very close to him because he had actually great regard for Urwah. And in Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya, Ibn Kathir, rahimullah, he relates, قال عمر بن عبد العزيز ما أحد أعلم من عروة. The person who is the most knowledgeable in our time is عروة. So you can see how much regard he had for عروة. That he regarded him that there's no one who is more knowledgeable than عروة. But the very interesting thing is what he mentions after that. So he said there's no one who's more knowledgeable than عروة. But after that, what does he say? وما أعلمه يعلم شيئا أجهله. That I don't think he knows anything which I am ignorant of. So what does this here mean? That Urwah is the most knowledgeable, but I know everything that he knows. So I could also come into this bracket of being the most knowledgeable. And you can see how young he was. But even though Umar ibn Abdul Azīz mentioned this, وَمَا أَعْلَمُهُ يَعْلَمُ شَيْءًا أَجْهَلُهُ, this incident is enough to show us that even though he felt that his knowledge can equal to that of the leading tabi'i and the senior faqih of Medina, it is very clear that Urwah knew what Umar ibn Abdul Azīz did not know. You can see that here, Urwah is actually informing Umar ibn Abdul Azīz of a narration, and Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is unaware of it. So nevertheless, the objective of this is that Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, he simply wanted Urwah to reflect again and to make sure that he is transmitting this here accurately. لَكِنَّ الْمَقْصُودَ الْإِحْتِيَاطُ وَالْإِسْتِثْبَاتُ لِيَتَذَكَّرَ الرَّاوِي وَيَتَجَنَّبُ مَا عَسَاهُ يَعْرِضُ مِنْ نِسْيَانٍ وَغَلَطٍ. Just saying that make sure you're not making a mistake or you forgot some of the details. Make sure you're quoting it accurately. Then Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, he explained, he's giving the reason of why he wants Urwah to make sure. He says, "Awa inna Jibreel huwa alladhi aqama li Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam waqt as-salah." Are you sure that Jibreel alayhi salam actually came down and he practically showed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the times of prayer? So now there are two ways to understand this here. So the one is, Alama Baji rahimahullah, he explains the reason for the astonishment. وَالتَّعَجُّبْ مِنْ أَيْ يَكُونَ مِثْلَ هَذَا مِنْ أَمْرِ الصَّلَاةِ مَعَ أَنَّهَا رَأْسُ هَذَا الدِّينِ وَأَهَمُّ أُمُورِهِ لَمْ يَصِلْ إِلَيْهِ عِلْمُهُ مَعَ اجْتِهَادِهِ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ وَالْإِهْتِمَامِ بِأَمْرِ الشَّرِيعَةِ لَا سِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ الَّتِي إِلَيْهِ إِقَامَتُهَا وَهُوَ الْإِمَامُ فِيهَا فعظم عليهم أن يكون قد ذهب عليه مثل هذا من شأنها ومعرفة سبب إقامة أوقاتها ومن الذي أقامها. So this is what that he's expressing, this astonishment. How come I don't know about this? It's such a great event, you know, and knowing that in the starting and the end time of the prayer. But besides this, Ibn Abdul Barr, rahimahullah, he mentions another statement which could indicate really to the reason of the astonishment. But basically, Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, he agreed, okay, that you think I must perform my time before the shadow of every object which is standing, which is twice its length. But are you really sure that Jibreel alayhi salam actually descended to show this? So he's not doubting the mas'ala. Rather, he's doubting that Jibreel alayhi salam actually came down and showed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam the times of prayers. وَلَا يُعْرَفْ أَثْلَ ذَلِكَ كَيْفَ كَانَمْ أَبِنُزُولْ مِنْ جِبْرِيلِ بِهَا عَلَى النَّبِي sallallahu alayhi salam. أم بما سنه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لأمته كما سن غير ما شيء وفرضه في الصلاة والزكاة والحج مما لا يمكن أن يقول كل ذي علم أن جبريل نزل بذلك كله والأمر في هذا واضح يغني عن الإكثار That is what Ibn Abdul Barr rahimullah mentioned. That the reason why Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is really astonished is because he is now thinking that did Jibreel alayhi salam actually come? You sure it wasn't Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam who just showed the ummah that this is the starting time of prayer and that's the end time of prayer? Are you 100% sure that it's Jibreel alayhi salam who actually came down to show? So he agrees on the masala that I must pray my prayer before the shadow. So he's not doubting on the masala, but what he is doubting on is the fact that Jibreel alayhi salam descended. So in response to this, Urwah presented his sanad to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So what does Urwah says? قال عروة كذلك كان بشير بن أبي مسعود الأنصاري يحدث عن أبيه. Now Urwah is quoting it from Bashir ibn Abi Mas'ud. So this means that the first time he took the shortcut, he didn't mention the sanad in full. Only after Umar ibn Abdul Aziz expressed this astonishment, now he's mentioning that actually I didn't hear it directly from Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari. Rather, I heard it from the son whose name was Bashir. So Bashir, he's the son of Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari, and we spoke about Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari in detail. So Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah mentioned with regards to Bashir, وَبَشِيرْ هَذَا وُلِدَ عَلَىٰ عَهْدِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَأَبُوهُ أَبُو مَسْعُودٍ الْأَنصَارِ. That he was born in the era of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and his father is Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari. So he was born in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now if you look in the footnotes, you see there's it's a quotation from Ibn al-Hadha in his book, At-Ta'rif biman dhukira fi Muwaṭṭa Malik ibn Anas min al-Rijal wal-Nisa. So this book here was also printed by the Wizaratul Awqaf of Morocco. And there are many free PDFs of it online. If you want it, you can just go put the Arabic on Google and you can download a free PDF. So one point, if you consider downloading the PDF, is that you can see the reference here is given as page 51. But before that, there's actually an introduction that it's close to 470 pages. So if you want to check this up, then you must know that it will be on page 506. Because first you have this long introduction, and thereafter it will lead you then to page 51. So in this book, it's quoted from Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, that he's saying that this Bashir, he was born in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he did not meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قال مسلم بن الحجاج ولد بشير في حياة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو من الطبقة الأولى من التابعين من أهل المدينة. That is from the highest rank of the tabi'in. He's not from the sahaba. He was born in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he did not meet the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. However, there were others who actually considered Bashir to be a sahabi. They felt that no, he did meet the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and therefore. So now if you look at your table, you can see Abu Bakr ibn Hazm. By now, I don't even have to tell you to look at your table. I'm sure you know it off by heart that Abu Bakr ibn Hazm, he is the student of Urwah. So when he quoted it, then look at how he quotes it. So his narration, it comes in Al-Mu'jam al-Kabir. And likewise, in At-Tamheed. So in Al-Mu'jam al-Kabir, فَحَدَّثَ عُرْوَةُ عُمَرَ قال حدثني أبو مسعود الأنصاري أو قال بشير بن أبي مسعود كلاهما. This word كلاهما, it's a word which you need to underline, which you need to take note of. كلاهما قد صحب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Both the father and the son, they came into the company of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this clearly comes in the narration of المعجم الكبير when Abu Bakr ibn Hazm is quoting it. So based on these wordings in Usul al-Ghaba, Ibn al-Athir, rahimahullah, he mentions, under the entry, he says, Bashir ibn Uqba, and then he mentions the whole lineage. Thereafter, he said, أَدَّرَكَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ سَلَمْ صَغِيرًا وَلَهُ وَلِأَبِيهِ صُحْبَةً. So in Usul al-Ghaba, page 123, it's mentioned that both Bashir and his father, they are both companions. They both came into the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then Ibn al-Athir, he quotes the siya kilahuma qad sahiba an-nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He quotes these words of Abu Bakr ibn Hazm. So that means he's relying on these words. He's relying on the word which comes through one of the asanid of this report to establish that the son is also a sahabi. However, as you can see, Imam Muslim rahmullah is claiming that he was not a sahabi. So that means others held a different view. So in al-Isaba fi tamyiz al-sahaba, Abd ibn Hajar rahmullah, he claims that there's actually a whole big confusion here. There's a confusion, so there's he gives different reasons. So the first reason is that there's a confusion. So you can write this as point number one. That there's a confusion here with the other son of Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari. So Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari, he had two sons. The one son's name was Ayyub, and the second son's name was Bashir. So Ayyub is the one who became then a Sahabi. So Ayyub ibn Abi Mas'ud al-Ansari, he is the Sahabi. Or Ayyub ibn Aqbat ibn Umar, he is the Sahabi. And Bashir, he's not a Sahabi. So this here is the first answer which he gives. Then Hafiz ibn Hajar, he quotes this report which I just told you now about Abu Bakr ibn Hazm. But then he comments on it and he says, وَهُوَ مِن تَخْلِيطِ أَيُّوبِ ابْنِ عُقْبَةِ وَإِنَّمَا رَوَاهُ عُرْوَةَ عَنْ بَشِيرِ ابْنِ أَبِي مَسْعُودَ عَنْ أَبِيهِ كَمَا هُوَ فِي الصَّحِيحِينَ وَغَيْرِمَا لَكِيَا إِنَّ مُوَطَّى. He's mentioning that here is a mix-up between the two sons. The other son is the Sahabi, not Bashir. Bashir is not the Sahabi. So that's the one answer which he gives. The second answer which he gives is he says that actually in the Sanad, there's a whole big misunderstanding on the marja of the Damir. There's a confusion on the antecedent of the pronoun. So listen to the sentence. He says, وَرَوَى بْنُ مَنْدَى مِنْ طَرِيقِ سَعِيدِ بْنِ عَبْدِ الْعَزِيزِ عَنْ إِبْنِ حَلْبَسِ عَنْ بَشِيرِ بْنِ أَبِي مَسْعُودِ وَكَانَ مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ. So the word كَانَ مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ, what's the marja of the dhamir? Who is this kana referring to? So Hafiz ibn Hajar rahmallah remarks on this here and he says, وَالضَّمِيرُ فِي هَذَيْنِ الطَّرِيقَيْنِ يُحْتَمَلُ أَن يَعُودَ عَلَى أَبِي مَسْعُودِ. Probably you can claim that, okay, it's going back to Abu Mas'ud. So it's going back to the father. So the father, he was definitely a Sahabi. We spoke about him as a very senior Sahabi. So this is what Hafiz ibn Hajar is claiming in Al-Isabah. But we then can respond to Hafiz ibn Hajar rahmallah with this exact same narration. And that is why I told you, look at the words kilahuma. That Abu Bakr ibn Hazm in his narration, it clearly comes kilahuma qad sahiba Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So yeah, you're looking at this other tariqah of which Ibn Manda transmitted wa kana min as-sahaba and trying to make the interpretation. But here it's very clearly mentioned. There's no room for interpretation here. So we're saying that here it's very clear that both of them were from the Sahaba. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahmallah, then he gives a third answer. So in this third answer, he's mentioning that you have some narrators who quoted the siyah only from the son Bashir, and thereafter you have the words wa kana min as-sahaba. But there's actually, wa kana min as-sahabi Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but there's actually a missing link, and that missing link is the father. So they basically dropped off the name of the father and then mentioned wa kana min as-sahabi Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is incorrect because they ought to first bring the name of the father and then they could mention wa kana min as-sahabi Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because the father was from the sahaba. They said, wa rawaynahu fil khabri thalith min fawaid abi al-abbas al-asam. قال حدثنا أبو عتبة قال حدثنا بقية قال حدثنا سعيد بن عبد العزيز عن ابن حلبس قال قال بشير بن أبي مسعود وكان من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then the narration is اتقوا الله وعليكم بالجماعة. So then what Hafiz ibn Hajar is now saying, he's saying لكن عندي أنه سقط منه قوله عن أبيه. That you are supposed to be بشير بن أبي مسعود عن أبيه وكان من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now it will mean that the father was from the Sahaba. So until here, you should probably have the following points in your notes. That number one, Urwah, he cites his source, and that is Bashir ibn Abi Mas'ud. He did not hear it directly from Abu Mas'ud, rather he heard it from the son, Bashir ibn Abi Mas'ud. That's the first point you must have written. The second point in the narration of one of the main narrators of this year, and that is Abu Bakr ibn Hazm. Imam Malik is narrating it from Imam Zuhri, who's narrating it from Urwah, but another person who's narrating it from Urwah, and that is Abu Bakr ibn Hazm, he is clearly mentioning that Bashir was a Sahabi. And the third point which you must have written is that Ibn al-Athir, who gathered the names of Sahaba, he also agreed that yes, Bashir is a Sahabi. The fourth point is that Hafiz ibn Hajar rahmallah, who also wrote on the Sahaba, Al-Isaba fi Tamyiz al-Sahaba, he said that no, he's not a Sahabi, and he gave various reasons. That the first reason is that some narrators are confusing this son, Bashir, with the other son, whose name was Ayyub. That's the first answer. The second answer is that when the narrator said, wa kana min as-sahaba, they're actually referring to the father. And the third is that Bashir, in some of the tariq, in some of the turuq, it's just mentioned Bashir wa kana min ashabi Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but Ibn Hajar is mentioning that it's actually dropped off an abihi, so that wa kana min ashabi Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is actually a description of abihi. So the conclusion is that according to Hafiz Ibn Hajar, Bashir is not a Sahabi, but he was a very great Tabi'i. And therefore, in Fathul Bari, he mentions, وَهُوَ تَابِعِيٌّ جَلِيلٌ. It is a very senior Tabi'i. Now, a Tabi'i, a person who was born in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and he did not meet the Prophet ﷺ, he is regarded as a Mukhadharam. He is referred to as a Mukhadharam. So this is the terminology. A Mukhadharam is a person who was born in the era of the Prophet ﷺ, but he did not meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahmallahu mentions in Nuzhatun Nadar on page 113, وَبَقِيَ بَيْنَ الصَّحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ طَبَقَةٌ أُخْرَى اُخْتُلِفَ فِي إِلْحَاقِهِمْ بِأَيِّ الْقِسْمَيْنِ. So here already you can see that there's ikhtilaf. Some scholars mentioned that even if they were born in the Prophet sallallahu in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they did not meet him or see him, they would still be regarded as a sahabi. But others say no, that they would be regarded as tabi'in. So this group who were born in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam but they did not meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what are they called? Wahumul mukhadharamun alladhina adraku al-jahiliyyah wal islam wa lam yarau an-nabiy sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Interestingly, in Nuzhatun Nazar, after mentioning this year, Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimullah, he then explains that Ibn Abdul Barr rahimullah regarded the mukhadharamin to be from the sahaba. So he says, فَعَدَّهُمُ ابْنُ عَبْدِ الْبَرِّ فِي الصَّحَابَةِ. Now, you know the status of Ibn Abdul Barr. We quoted it and we mentioned it so many times that he wrote the greatest commentary of the Muwaṭṭa. So that means he plays a very important role here. And Hafiz ibn Hajar is claiming, فَعَدَّهُمُ ابْنُ عَبْدِ الْبَرِّ فِي الصَّحَابَةِ. Ibn Abdul Barr, rahimahullah, he considered mukhadharamin, those who were born in the era of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they did not meet him. He considered them to be from the sahaba. However, this is not the place to discuss whether he's correctly attributing this to Ibn Abdul Barr or whether it's correct to attribute this to Ibn Abdul Barr or not. When you do the lessons of Nuzhatun Nazar, then we prove that it's actually there's misquoting Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah. But if you want to assume that maybe Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah did indeed say it, then it will mean that Bashir was a mukhadram, and a mukhadram is a sahabi. Therefore, Bashir is a sahabi according to Ibn Abdul Barr. But we say, like we said, that Ibn Hajar is actually misquoting from Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah. And therefore, we can just say that according to Ibn al-Athir rahimahullah, he was a sahabi. But according to others, he was not a sahabi. Now, looking at this narration, that what Urwah is saying, this response of Urwah, so what do we understand? We understand that the first time when he quoted it with a missing link. And now he's quoting it muttasil, and he's now quoting the full sanad. Only after he was questioned, only after Umar ibn Abdul Azīz expressed his astonishment, that is when he quoted it with the sanad. So that shows that he first quoted it mursalan, and after that, now he's quoting it muttasilan. So that's one point to keep in mind. Then another point here is that this the imamat of Jibreel alayhi salam, it has been quoted in this incident as marfu' qawli and as marfu' fi'li. So now what does this mean? So basically a marfu' narration is that which links up to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it discusses the statement or the action or the approval of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anything that discusses any something of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's considered as marfu'. Now you get different types of marfu'. So in Nuzhatun Nazar, Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah said that wahuwa, meaning the matn, imma ayyantahi ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa yaqtadi lafdha, that either it reaches up to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and it is explaining the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, imma tasrihan aw hukman, whether it is directly or indirectly, anna al manqul bi dhalika al isnad min qawli sallallahu alayhi wa sallam aw min fi'lihi aw min taqririhi. So if it is from the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then it's called marfu' qawli. And if it's an action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it's called marfu' fi'li. So now, yeah, if you look in the Muwatta, this entire event of the imamat of Jibreel alayhi salam for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's quoted as marfu' fi'li because it's Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari. Can you see how it is marfu' fi'li? Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari, he is quoting the action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is how most of the others also transmitted this from this statement or this quotation from Abu Mas'ud. So Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari is explaining what happened between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Jibreel alayhi salam. So therefore, the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and of Jibreel alaihi wasallam are being quoted in the third person because it's actions which are being related. However, there are others who quoted this incident directly from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they quote that Abu Mas'ud is actually quoting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is telling us what transpired. So therefore, he uses words in the first person. So on your chart, if you look for three names, look for the name of Layth ibn Sa'd and Usama ibn Zayd and Sufyan ibn Uyayna. So if you want, you can write a qaf by their names just to indicate that they quoted this as marfu' qawli. So when these three narrators, they quoted it from Ibn Shihab. So one teacher, but they are quoting it that Abu Mas'ud is actually attributing words to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he's not quoting an action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's not saying thumma sallah, he prayed. Sallah. Rather, he's actually mentioning that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned it. So for the first two, Layth ibn Sa'd and Usama ibn Zayd, it's muttafaqun alayhi. Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim rahimahumullah, they narrated this transmission from Layth ibn Sa'd and Usama ibn Zayd. وقال سمعت بشير ابن ابي مسعود يقول سمعت ابا مسعود يقول. Now look, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول. So can you see now he's going to be mentioning words of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, not the action of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now these are words of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying نزل جبريل فأمني, he made imamat for me. فصليت معه, I perform salah. It's not فصلى, it's فصليت. ثم صليت معه ثم صليت معه ثم صليت معه ثم صليت معه يحسب بأصابعه خمس صلوات. So can you see now it's being quoted as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioning what transpired, not Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari, and therefore it's being used, the words are being used in the first person. Likewise, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he also quotes this as the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this here is transmitted marfu' قولي, and it's transmitted as marfu' fi'li. Nevertheless, it's still marfu'. So whether you regard it as qawli, words being attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or whether you regard it as fi'li, actions being attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ultimately it's still attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that brings us to the end of this narration in the Muwaṭṭa. So the narration of the Muwaṭṭa, it stops here. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he did not report anything further. However, the narration continues. So in the transmission of Ma'mar from Zuhri, so you can look for his name on your chart. So then you can see it's Musannaf Abdul Razak. So Abdul Razak narrates from Ma'mar from Zuhri. So then he quotes now additional words. That after this year, then it was said, فَمَا زَالَ يَعْلَمُ وَقْتَ الصَّلَاةِ بِعَلَامَةٍ حَتَّى غَابَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. That now, Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, now he became convinced. Now he made a concerted effort that now is that every day, for the rest of his life, he is going to now ensure that he's performing the prayer within the time, within the correct time. So now who knows how many years later was that for him to pass away. So for how many years did he now make sure that he's going to perform salah in the mustahab time? So if you paid attention in the previous lessons, you would know when this incident took place, and you will also know in which year he passed away. So automatically then you will know for how many years of his life. Actually, with this cell phone, I can't even see the chat, so you can't even make this thing interactive. Because to check the chat, I need to go out of the screen, then come here to click on more, then click on chat, and then only I can see. Yes, mashallah, you got it right here, 15. Because you remember we said that this year, so this mashallah shows you got a very, very super strong mind. And really attentive. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. So because we quoted that ثُمَّ دَخَلَتْ سَنَةً سَبْعِي وَثَمَانِينَ فَقِيهَا عَزَلَ الْوَلِيدُ بْنُ عَبْدِ الْمَلِكِ هِشَامَ بْنَ إِسْمَعِيلَ عَنْ عِمْرَةِ الْمَدِينَةِ. So in the year 87, and we said that he passed away in 101, so you can say 14, 15 years. That's more or less, because in those times they used to work on estimates. So imagine for the next 14, 15 years of his life, is continuously making sure for each and every salah, I must make sure that I'm praying it within the mustahab time. And then Alama ibn Abdul Barr, rahimahullah, he also quoted this from via Habib ibn Abi Marzuq. And there it also comes from Mazala Umar indahu alamat al-sa'at, that he could keep in our context to say we had separate clocks. Like, you know, put an alarm that I must make sure that salah is performed in time. ينظر فيها حتى قبض رحمه الله. It shows that Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, he was generally unaware, and now he was taught something by Urwah, and thereafter he then started to make amal. Like Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, he also made a concerted effort to learn the times of Salah. So one is that he put the clocks there, put the alarms, like I say, for our context, to make sure. And then he also made this concerted effort that he needs to learn. So he's already regarded as a mujtahid and a governor. فَمَا زَالَ عُمَرْ يَتَعَلَّمُ وَقَتَ الصَّلَةِ, that he would learn the times of prayer. So it shows that he was genuinely unaware. Now this means that you have great scholars like Mughira ibn Shu'ba and Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, who really did not know about this incident of the Imamat of Jibreel alayhi salam. So Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he said, وَإِنَّهُمَا إِنَّمَا جَهِلَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ نُزُولَ جِبْرِيلِ بفرض أوقات الصلوات وكانوا يعتقدون ذلك من سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأن القرآن ليس فيه آية مفصحة بذلك ترفع الإشكال. It's not clearly mentioned in the Quran. So therefore they had a valid excuse not to know. ولو كان فيه آية تتلى ما جهلها عمر بن عبد العزيز ولا مثله من العلماء وقد جاز على كثير منهم جهل كثير من السنن الواردة على ألسنة خاصة العلماء. So you can see what he's mentioning, that it's fine if you have a very knowledgeable person who doesn't know a simple fact, simply because it does not come in the Quran. So now you go and you ask the leading mufti of your madrasa, you go ask the senior sheikh al hadith, very elderly scholar, you go ask him some simple masala of salah, and he says, la a'lamu, then it's fine. It's not something which was mentioned in the Quran. Here this here is proof. So that's what he's saying. He's saying, وَلَا أَعْلَمُ أَحَدًا مِّنَ الصَّحَابَةِ إِلَّا وَقَدْ شَدَّ عَنْهُ بَيْنَ عِلْمِ الْخَاصَّةِ وَارِدَ بِنَقْلِ الْأَحَادِ أَشْيَاءَ حَفِظَهَا غَيْرُهُ. Ibn Abdul Barr said that each and every Sahabi, even from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and you know the incident which comes in Usul al-Shashi, and likewise Umar radiallahu anhu, there were times when they did not know certain things about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then in al-Istizkar, he says, وليس بنكير ان يكون عمر بن عبد العزيز خفي عليه حديث نزول جبريل على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بمواقيت الصلاه وقد خفي ذلك عن المغيرة بن شعبة وله صعبة واخبار الآحاد عند العلماء من علم الخاصة لا ينكر على احد جهل بعضها والإحاطة بها ممتنعة وما اعلم احدا من ائمة الامصار مع بحثهم وجمعهم الا وقد فاته شيء من السنن المروية من طريق الآحاد. Of a narration, and that narration comes in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, and he says, I don't know, you don't look down upon him. It's possible, it's fine, he doesn't know, he's not an angel, he's not alimul al-ghayb. So it's very important to show us that sometimes a very learned and a senior scholar can be unaware of something that is very basic. Now, inshallah, we'll go through all the benefits that we derive from this here. So you can put your heading in your notes, points that we learn from this narration. So the main point is of this narration, why Imam Malik rahimahullah brought it, is to show the time of the Asr Salah. But now there are numerous other benefits. We're going to go through as many benefits as possible. So the first benefit is that you can see from this narration that Mursal narrations were quoted freely and they were even accepted. That Urwah, he very casually quoted the narration Mursalan. And he didn't even feel that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is going to take exception. Why I'm not mentioning the Sanad? So he just mentioned it mursalan. Only after Umar ibn Abdul Aziz expressed his reservations, then he quoted it in full. So wa arsala urwatu al khabra, he narrated it mursalan, falam yunkir alayhi umaru irsalahu. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz didn't tell him, why are you quoting it mursalan? Couldn't you just tell me from the beginning that Bashir narrated it from his father? Why first you hid the name or you did not mention the name? وهذا يدل على اتفاقهما على القول بالمراسيل. So in some it comes على القول بالمراسيل, and in some fronts it comes على القبول بالمراسيل. That this here shows that they would all just accept Mursal narrations. And therefore, if Imam Malik rahimahullah mentioned Mursal narrations in his Muwaṭṭa, then he learned it from his seniors. So we cannot take and we cannot refute him for that. So only after. And the reason why Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is expressing concern is because he felt that this is such a major event. So it has nothing to do with Mursal. So therefore in Fath al-Bari, وَاسْتَدَلَّ بِهِ عِيَاذْ عَلَى جَوَازِ الْإِحْتِجَاجِ بِمُرْسَلِ الثِّقَةِ كَصَنِيعِ عُرْوَةِ حِينَ احْتَجَّ عَلَىٰ عُمَرْ. So can you see? And then he's mentioning, وَإِنَّمَا رَاجَعَهُ عُمَرْ لِتَثَبُّتِهِ فِيهِ لَا لِكَوْنِهِ لَمْ يَرَضَ بِهِ مُرْسَلًا. So this is what he's mentioning. So that's the first benefit that we get from this, that we can see earlier scholars, they very freely accepted Mursal narrations. The second benefit, for those of you who studied Ulumul Hadith, you can see that this year proves that Gharib narrations could be used as a proof. You know, under the chapter of Gharib narrations, there's so much discussion because some Sahaba radiallahu anhum, it seems that they did not accept. If only one person transmitted a report, they would make the person take an oath, they would make him bring a witness. And then also after them, there are many scholars who wanted that the same narration is to be transmitted by another chain. So a gharib narration is where you only have one person in a link who's quoting it. So this here shows that even if there's only one person who's quoting it, it is fine. Because Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is only hearing this from Urwah, isn't he? He didn't hear it from anyone else. And then he accepted it. And I started to learn the times of prayers. And he got this clock so that he can make sure that he now performs Salah on time. So وَفِيهِ دَلِيلٌ عَلَىٰ قَبُولِ خَبْرِ الْوَاحِدِ لِأَنَّ عُمَرْ قَبِلَ خَبْرَ عُرْوَى وَحْدَهُ فِيمَا جَهِلَ مِنْ أَمْرِ دِينِهِ. So can you see that this here shows that you can practice on a خَبْرُ الْوَاحِدِ. That's the second benefit. The third benefit that you get from this narration is that a scholar can mix with a leader and with a high profile person on condition that he feels secure that he's not going to be affected with the love of this world. So the objective of going to leaders and high profile individuals is to take deen to them and not take dunya from them. It's to take deen to them and not to take dunya from them. Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he explains, وَفِي الْحَدِيثِ مِنَ الْفَوَائِدِ دُخُولُ الْعُلَمَاءَ عَلَى الْعُمَرَاءِ. It's fine for ulama to go to the leaders, but why? وَإِنْكَارُهُمْ عَلَيْهِمْ مَا يُخَالِفُ السُّنَّةِ. They must go to the leaders, but then when they find things contradicting deen, they must then notify them. So that's one benefit which you get from this narration. And then Alama ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he mentions that look, the leaders, when they spend time with the scholars, then what a positive impact it has on them. You know, the in the Khanqa, they speak about the power of suhbah. So he said, وَفِي هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَيْضًا مَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ مِنْ صُحْبَةٍ لِلْأُمَرَاءِ وَالدُّخُولِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَإِذَا كَانَ الْأَمِيرُ أَوْ الْخَلِيفَةِ يَسْتَدِيمُ صُحْبَةَ الْعُلَمَاءِ فَأَجْدَرَ بِهِ أَنْ يَكُونَ عَدْلًا مَأْمُونًا. Umar ibn Abdul Azīz, he had a worldly position, but because he kept the ulama close to him, and because he sat in the company of ulama, therefore he says that he became adlan ma'munan. Wa kana Umar rahimahullah yashabu jama'atan min al-ulama kabni shihabin wa maymun ibn mahran wa raja ibn haywa wa kana qabla dhalika yashabu ubaydullah ibn abdullah wa urwa wa tabaqatihima. And from there you can see he actually became a mujtahid, he excelled and he surpassed ulama. So that's a great benefit, that no matter what your worldly position is, no matter what worldly qualification you have, still in the company of the ulama, and you will really, really excel. Now, viewing this from the opposite side, many times there will be rich and in the influential people from the community, and they will try to keep a very close connection with you as a scholar. So when you go to the masjid, after salah, they'll come and they want to spend time with you. They'll maybe even come visit you. Month of Ramadan, they send their dates for you, and they'll even send for you an Eid gift. So you should welcome them, and you must make them comfortable. I don't feel intimidated that this person here, he got so much dunya in his life. So now you feel intimidated, you feel vulnerable, you feel that they're going to have a negative impact on you. But obviously, this year, you need to do it under the guidance of your asatida, and you need to have a spiritual guide, you need to have a sheikh, because you can never feel secured with your own nafs. Sometimes you might feel, you might have noble intentions. Okay, I'll keep close to these influential and rich people. But then inadvertently, unknowingly, the dunya will come into your heart. So always remember that a true scholar, he's not changed by adverse company. Rather, he changes others. So you can see Urwah, he did not get changed. He did not get dunya from Umar ibn Abdul Azīz. Rather, he changed Umar ibn Abdul Azīz. So in al-istithkar, Alama ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he terminates the explanation of this first narration saying, كانوا يقولون خير الأمراء من صاحب العلماء وشر العلماء من صاحب الأمراء. The best of leaders are those who keep the connection with the ulama. But now these leaders can only have connection with the ulama if the ulama allow them to have connection with them. But now the next sentence is that وشر العلماء من صاحب الأمراء. So what is this going to mean? How can the umara have connection with the ulama if you are calling those ulama sharrul ulama? So then he said, if you want to mix with influential and rich people, then these are the conditions. Illa man qala bil haqq wa amara bil ma'ruf wa a'ana al-da'if. That you must do these things, then you can go to the rich and influential people. That you use you use your connection for them, and you tell them what if they're doing something which contravenes Sharia, then you tell them, and you advise them towards good. And maybe there might be people who are oppressed in the locality. There might be poor people, and the leader, he's sitting in his palace, he doesn't even know anything about it. So now you need to help them, and you need to make the leader aware. So that's the third benefit from this narration. The fourth benefit that we get from this narration is that it teaches us the method of objecting on someone who is close to us. وَمَا قَالَهُ أَبُو مَسْعُودٍ الْأَنْصَارِهِ سُنَّ فِي مُلَاطَفَةِ الْإِنْكَارِ لِمَا يَجِبُ إِنْكَارُهُ لَا سِيِّمَا لِمَنْ عُلِمَنْ قِيَادُهُ لِلْحَقِّ وَحِرْصُهُ عَلَى مَعْرِفَتِهِ فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ أَقْرَبْ لَهُ إِلَى الرُّجُوعِ إِلَى الْحَقِّ وَأَسْلَمَ لِنَفْسِهِ مِنَ الْغَضَبِ الْمُوجِبِ لِلْعِنَادِ وَكَذَا يَجِبُ لِمَنْ أَمَرَ بِمَعْرُوفٍ وَنَهَى عَنْ مُنْكَرٍ أَيْ يَرْفَقَ فِي أَمْرِهِ وَنَهْيِهِ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ أَوْ يَخْشَى. So this here, it shows that the method of how you object on someone. The fifth benefit that you get from this is that a scholar is within his right to seek clarification of something that seems odd. So وَاسْتِثْبَاتِ الْعَالِمْ فِي مَا يَسْتَغْرِبُهُ السَّامِعُ. That means you take a fatwa to another alim, and the alim says that this mufti didn't give any proof. He needs to provide evidence. So that's fine. He is within his right to ask for the dala'il. You can see Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is telling him that think what you are saying. He's asking him, he's making sure. So you can ask for dala'il. The sixth benefit is that if you, as a youngster, if you have to ask an elder for his evidence, then that's not against adab. Do you know sometimes a student in the class, he feels that I can't ask the teacher because now I need to have adab for the teacher. I need to have respect. 25-year-old Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is asking evidence from the fuqaha, from the faqih of Medina, 70-year-old Umar ibn Abdul Azīz. And that's the same difference between us and our asatida, isn't our asatida around that age, and we are around this age. So therefore, asking a senior teacher who's so elderly for some evidence, that's not against adab. The seventh benefit that we get from this narration, that okay, the student can ask the teacher for his dalil. But then the seventh benefit is that the elder, he should not feel bad if the junior is asking for his evidence. Urwah is around 70 years old. Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is around 25 years old. Yet Urwah did not object. Rather, he responded. He produced his evidence. He didn't think that what does this youngster think of himself? That he just became a governor. Now he wants to question me. He doesn't know that I'm the great faqih of Medina. He thinks now he's too knowledgeable. He didn't think all of that. No, he gave his proof. So one day when you become an elder, or maybe if you have a person who's maybe 15 years old in first year and he asks you for dalil, then don't take offense, give you a dalil. That's the seventh benefit. The eighth benefit is that when two scholars differ, then they should resort back to the sunnah. وَالرُّجُوعُ عِنْدَ التَّنَازُعِ إِلَى السُّنَّةِ. But,
sorry.
Yeah, so but this here is it's for those who have the ability of going back to the sunnah. For us as muqallids, we should do so within the framework of the madhab. We learn the usul of iftah. So if we are not fit to go back to the sunnah, then we apply the usul that is taught in iftah when you have ikhtilaf, and you take that as your starting point to now determine what will be the correct view. So that's the eighth benefit from this. The ninth benefit of this year is that it shows the lofty status of Umar ibn Abdul Azīz. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah said, وَفِيهِ فَضِيلَةُ Umar ibn Abdul Azīz. He mentions this in Fathul Bari. The tenth benefit of this year, it also shows us the humility of Ata. That now you all studied ilm, you must have humility. Look at all. Firstly, he was of such advanced age. Secondly, he was from the seven leading fuqaha. Third, he was a well-respected scholar. Yet, when someone who would be equal to the age of his grandson objected, he did not become defensive and annoyed. Rather, he just strengthened his point and he furnished his evidence. So it shows us the humility of Ata, and we should try to inculcate this within us. That if someone who is much junior to us has to ask us for our dalil, even if the tone might not seem very good, then too, we should provide the dalil. The 11th benefit that we get to afford us here is that it shows us the virtue of hastening to perform salah within the mustahab time. وَفِيهِ فَضِيلَةُ الْمُبَادَرَةِ بِالصَّلَاةِ فِي الْوَقْتِ الْفَاضِلِ. And we'll discuss the mustahab times according to Hanafis. The 12th benefit that we get from this narration is that sometimes it makes more sense to give practical examples. You can see Jibreel alayhi salam, he could have just came and told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam, today you must perform salah at this time. Next day he comes, okay, now today you perform salah at that time. But Jibreel alayhi salam actually came and he showed the Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam practically. But sometimes, especially if you're teaching in a maktab, if you're teaching young kids, or if you're teaching a new Muslim, or if you're teaching someone who didn't have the opportunity of learning, then you need to give a practical demonstration. وَعَلَمْ أَنَّ صَلَاةَ جِبْرِيلِ قَصَرَ مِنْهَا تَبْلِيغَ صِفَةِ الصَّلَاةِ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِأَنَّ التَّبْلِيغَ بِالْفَعْلِ أَشَدُّ بَيَانًا وَاخْتِصَارًا لِأَنَّ مِنَ الْأَفْعَالِ مَا لَا تُحِيطُ بِهِ الْعِبَارَةِ. So this year is, you can see it was the very first time when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was starting to perform salah. The first time he came and he showed practically. So that is why I mentioned that it's when someone is in the beginning stages of learning. But obviously, if you have to ever teach iftar, you teach takhassus fil hadith, or you're teaching a postgraduate course, then you must make the students do the work. You don't then give them. This here is what Mullah Anwar Shah Kashmiri taught, and this is what Mullah Fazlur Rahman stresses upon. And he says that Mullah Habibur Rahman would also do this here. His teacher, Mullah Habibur Rahman, that when you are teaching takhassus, actually from Dara, from the final year, Mullah Habibur Rahman would do this, that the students must do the work and the ustad must then overlook. The 13th benefit from this year is that imagine salah is such a lofty ibadah. It's a that to give salah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually called the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he gave it as a personal gift to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then to teach the times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then sent one of the greatest angels multiple times to come down. So can you see how great salah is? Allah ta'ala called the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to give him salah. And then to teach the times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent one of the greatest angels 10 times. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَرَادَ تَشْرِيفَ أَوْقَاتِ الصَّلَاةِ فَلَمَّا كَانَ فَرْضَهَا فِي الْأَسْرَابِ حَضْرَةِ الْمَلَائِكَةِ أَرْسَلَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. You can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then sent Jibreel alayhi salam. The next benefit, so what number is this now? Number 14. And I hope all of you got all 14 so far. So the general ruling is that we do not object on someone who's leaving out a mustahab action. In fact, at times when you put lots of emphasis on mustahab actions, it could lead to becoming a bid'ah. But there are times when you can admonish a person for leaving out a mustahab action. So for example, if your son has to leave out a mustahab action, or if your student omits something which is against adab. So this year, you know, Mulana Hakim Muhammad Akhtar Rahimahullah, he would stress a lot on it, that the correcting students and murids when they leave out adab. And he would say that sometimes the sheikh or the teacher, they feel that, how can I tell the student to respect me? And then he allows the student to show this respect. But the student then is depriving himself of so much. So he says that the faqahat of islah, that now you are making your own islah. Your nafs is telling you that I can't tell the student to straighten my shoes. Or I can't tell, imagine now you tell a student how you'll even feel. So your nafs is telling you that you can't tell a student to respect you. So Mullah Hakim Muhammad Akhtar Rahmallah, really emphasize on this a lot. So if you tell your student, if he leaves out something from adab, then it's totally fine to admonish them. But just so you can see, Urwah is admonishing him on leaving out a mustahab. But more importantly, so even if there is a difference of opinion on something, then on the awam and those who don't have a very close contact connection with you, then you don't make inkar on them. You know, Imam Nawawi rahmallah, he mentioned in his commentary of Muslim, ثم العلماء إنما ينكرون ما أجمع عليه أما المختلف فيه فلا إنكار فيه. That if there's something where there's اختلاف, that you have one mufti saying this, another mufti saying that, and if a person decides that he's not going to follow that other mufti and he's going to eat prawns, then you don't make inkar, especially if it's your own spouse. You don't make inkar, you let them eat the prawns. But while because it's permissible, this is when in general circumstances. But there are times when even when there's a difference of opinion, you can correct a person when he's like, you know, really trust your ilm. He's following his deen from you. Whatever you tell him of his deen, he's following it. Then even if another mufti is saying that, you tell him, no, you must follow this here. Because look in this case here, that Urwa is obviously a mujtahid. He's from the Fuqaha al-Sab'ah. So he knows very well that in Iraq, all the ulama of Iraq, they praying Asr after Mithlain. So he could have said, okay, Urwa, you're following the scholars of Iraq, it's fine. But here, although there was ikhtilaf, he made inkar. So this year is from the usul of iftar, and there's a whole long discussion of it in when you're doing the Mufti course. So even though there was a difference of opinion, he still took the liberty of correcting. The 15th benefit that we get from this year is that what we mentioned earlier, that a scholar can be super knowledgeable, but there could be something which is considered as basic and he is not aware of that. وَقَدْ جَازَ عَلَى كَثِيرٍ مِنْهُمْ جَهْلُ كَثِيرٍ مِنَ السُنَنِ الْوَارِدَ عَلَى أَلْسِنَةِ خَاصَّةِ الْعُلَمَاءِ إِنَّ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ أَحَدًا مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ إِلَّا وَقَدْ شَذَّ. That's the 15th benefit. And then the 16th benefit is that there is no harm in learning until death. Doesn't mean now you became muhaqqiqul zaman wa mutaqqiqul milla, you regarded as the great mufti, now you can't learn. You can see Umar ibn Abdul Azīz is the big mujtahid. He's such an accomplished scholar. But yet, he publicly learned, and that is how they could actually say, remember, for mazala Umar yata'allamu waqta salah. So therefore, you can continuously learn. So those are a few benefits which you can get from that. If you got all 16, then mashallah. And now please try then to practice on what you learned from there. That finally brings us to the termination of this first narration. Now that we completed this entire narration, and you have the full incident in front of you, now I would like to quote the words of Ibn Ashur, that you can understand how unique this narration is. So he mentions in Kashful Muwaṭṭa on page 61, هذا الحديث أغر. This here is a very, very unique narration. Why is it such a unique hadith? ففيه مراجعة فقيهين لأميرين وفيه تلقي تابعي عن تابعي وصحابي عن صحابي ورسول عن رسول. Can you see that Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم is a messenger and Jibreel عليه السلام is a messenger. Sahabi from a Sahabi, مغيرة بن شعبة and Abu Mas'ud al-Ansari. تابعي عن تابعي. And then فقيهين لأميرين. So this is such a unique narration. هذا الحديث أغر وفيه مراجعة فقيهين لأميرين وفيه تلقي تابعي عن تابعي وصحابي عن صحابي ورسول عن رسول. Now inshallah, I want to conduct a comparison and show you the differences between the different transmissions of the Muwatta. So as we go through the Muwatta, at times I show you maybe sometimes the difference between the transmission of Yahya ibn Yahya and another person who transmitted the Muwatta from Imam Malik. But for the first narration, since we are Hanafis, I would like to show you the difference and the contrast between the Muwatta of Imam Muhammad and the transmission of Yahya. So this is just that you can understand the stark differences, because you remember we said that the Muwatta of Imam Muhammad is like a completely different and independent book. And that is why we do not call it Muwatta al-Imam Malik riwayati Muhammad. But we say Muwatta Imam Malik bi riwayati Yahya, because Yahya is transmitting the Muwatta from Imam Malik. But Imam Muhammad, he based a book on the Muwatta of Imam Malik, and therefore we're attributing it to him. We're saying Muwatta Muhammad. So therefore, I want to show you the differences. And also, when reading this first narration of Muwatta Imam Muhammad, then I also will give you ijāzāt for this kitab, that you know, alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with really short asanid. So if you have to live 30 years from now, then people will travel to you just to get this isnad. I already told you that even from now, I told you the royal treatment we got from Arabs just so that they could get ijaza. So imagine that now, if that's what we get now, imagine after 30 years, how much more, and after 50 years, and if you live till 60, 70 years, then it will be like you have one of the shortest chains. So alhamdulillah, we have a very short chain for the Muwatta of Imam Muhammad rahimahullah. So Imam Muhammad rahimahullah, he starts his Muwatta with a completely different narration. And although Yahya ibn Yahya, he does cite that narration here, it's the ninth narration in the Muwatta of Yahya ibn Yahya. But Imam Muhammad, he did not commence with the same narration as Yahya ibn Yahya. Rather, he commenced with that narration, which is the ninth narration in the transmission of Yahya ibn Yahya. So inshallah, I will now quote the first narration of the Muwatta of Imam Muhammad. So if you are sitting, relaxing, then please sit in a tashahud position. You know, I told you, if you got your bottle of itar next to you, then please apply some itar, because now we're going to be quoting the narration with the sanad. So Imam Muhammad commences, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Abwaab al-Salah, Babu Qut al-Salah. So, Wabil Asanid al-Muttasila minna ila al-Imam al-Mujtahid al-Qadhi, Muassis al-Madhab al-Nu'mani, wa al-Nabiga al-Fiqh al-Islami, Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, قال أخبرنا مالك بن أنس عن يزيد بن زياد مولى بن حاشم عن عبد الله بن رافع مولى أم سلمة رضي الله عنها زوج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أنه سأله عن وقت الصلاة فقال أبو هريرة أنا أخبرك صل الظهر إذا كان ظلك مثلك والعصر إذا كان ظلك مثليك والمغرب إذا غربت الشمس والإشاء ما بينك وبين ثلث الليل فإن نمت إلى نصف الليل فلا نامت عيناك وصل الصبح بقلس قال محمد وهذا قول أبي حنيفة رحمه الله في وقت العصر وكان يرى الإسفار في الفجر وأما في قولنا فإنا نقول إذا زاد الظل على المثل فصار مثل الشيء وزيادة من حين زالت الشمس فقد دخل وقت العصر وأما أبو حنيفة فإنه قال لا يدخل وقت العصر حتى يصير الظل مثليه. So this is the transmission, the first narration which Imam Muhammad narrates on page 150 of the Darul Qalam front. So I give you, all those of you who are present for this live session, I give you ijaza for the Muwaṭṭa of Imam Muhammad rahimahullah. And inshallah, if Allah Ta'ala ever makes the means, then I will give it to you in writing. You know, it's important to have the ijazat in writing. The other day I quoted to you so many of my ijazat, isn't it? So what happens if one of you think that I'm just lying, that how did I hear from this particular sheikh? Then fine, come to my house and I'll show you to you what his signature, he clearly signed. So we got concrete evidence that he gave us ijazah. So any ijazah that I tell you or any claim that I make that I got ijazah from a particular sheikh, I can prove it to you. If you come to my house, I'll show you the sanad and I'll show you to you what his signature in his handwriting. So inshallah, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also grant the possibility that I can give it to you in writing. And then also, having said that, please remember that we don't study for ijazah. This year, you know, Sheikh Muhammad Awama, he really stresses upon it because, again, he was living in Medina Munawwara. And I told you how the Arabs, they go on. When you go for the Egyptian book fair also, you'll be in your hotel and they'll come to you like that. They go so much emphasis on asanin, but then they don't pay any attention to learning the fiqh of the hadith. So therefore, we study only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as an excuse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can raise us with the muhaddithin. And the muhaddithin, ultimately, in whose company they're going to be? In this world, you spend the time in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by being in the company of his breath. Isn't ahlul hadithi humu ahlul nabiyyi wa in lam yashabu naftahu anfasahu sahibu. So your day and night, for your whole life, just studying hadith, teaching hadith. That's how your day is spent in this world, in the company of the breath of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then in the year after, we want to be in the company. Firstly, we want to rest together with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina Munawwara, and then ultimately be in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Hafiz Ibn Hajar says, فَأَجَبَتُهُ إِلَى سُوَالِهِ رَجَاءَ الْإِنْدِرَاجِ فِي تِلْكَ الْمَسَالِكِ. You know, in a plane, you have those who are sitting in the first class, and then you have the cleaner in the third class. Ultimately, they'll all reach the same destination, isn't it? Doesn't mean that this person here is now cleaning the economy class, so now he's not going to reach the same destination. Ultimately, they all. So we're not even put to be, the comparison is not even valid. But we hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala includes us in the ranks with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that's our goal for studying. And it's not just to amass ijazat and then to show up. You know, in our, when Malana Huzaifa asked me that, how to describe yourself, I could have told him, put there that over 500 asanid. We could have put some big claim like that. Imagine how many more. But I told him, just put it, qualified from Azarwal and studied Andam from Tibran decide, that's enough. You don't need now to show off. It's not something to show off. Like now you're such a great person. You got so many asanid. So this year is a point which our elders really stress upon. So always keep this point in mind. And I told you that we will do the second narration, but unfortunately, you know that we plan and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plans, and Allah ta'ala is the best of planners. So inshallah, this is why it was tentative. So inshallah, we'll do the second narration tomorrow. جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته